Hey, everybody. Thanks for watching this week's Make Me Smart, or listening to it, or watching and listening simultaneously. Anyway, thanks for doing it, and I hope that you will subscribe to our YouTube page. It's super easy. Just smash that subscribe button and the like button while you're at it. Hello there, and welcome to Make Me Smart. I'm Molly Wood. And normally this is the part where Kai would jump in and say, I'm Kai Ryssdal, but not today. I'm filling in for Kai. He's out today. And so I'm going to steer the smart ship solo. But as you know, I'm never really solo because I have you, and none of us is as smart as all of us. I'm sad that Kai is not here for this conversation though today, because it's going to be great. We've been planning it for a while. We're going to talk about privacy, which I know what you're thinking. We talk about privacy a lot on this show, but today we're going to get into sort of the semantics, the actual term, and what it is starting to mean in the context of this tech-driven economy, this digital economy in which we find ourselves. Because I think we're starting to get a few mixed messages about privacy, and we're starting to realize that companies mean different things than we might mean when they say privacy. So there may be, for example, some confusing messages from Apple, which has positioned itself as Silicon Valley's privacy darling. But of course, the cell phone carrier that operates your iPhone can still gather plenty of information. Apps in the App Store might send information all over the place. Apple itself was collecting Siri recordings for quality control. You've got Google. Its apps are legendary for sharing information. It gathers a ton of data on you for advertising purposes. You've got Facebook, which is talking about privacy in every possible way. It just got a $5 billion fine over what were essentially data breaches. On Thursday, a federal appeals court said Facebook illegally collected and stored biometric data for millions of people without their consent. And of course, Facebook is saying, we're going to pivot Facebook and our entire platform to private messaging, which will still not exempt users from information being collected for the purposes of targeted advertising. So today we're going to kind of dig into what these companies mean when they say privacy, what you mean when you think privacy, and what expectations we might all start to agree on in the best case scenario. Laura Moy is an associate professor of law and the director of the Communications and Technology Law Clinic at Georgetown. Welcome to the show, Laura.
Hi, how are you?
Thanks for being here. All right, so you heard me do this setup about what privacy might mean. What in your mind does privacy to a person mean versus what it might mean to a tech company, especially an advertising-driven tech company?
This question is such a great question that I could go on and on about. So I think...
let's do it.
Yeah, let's do it. So I think, you know, I think that in many ways we kind of take the word privacy for granted. You know, we say that we want privacy online, and usually what we mean by that is that we want to know that our information is protected, that it's not going to be shared with other companies or other users without us knowing about it and getting a chance to consent. But I think that some of the problems that we're seeing in the digital economy now indicate a much broader understanding of privacy that really kind of takes us back to what privacy originally means for us in an analog context, in a pre-digital context. You know, so I like to think of as a sort of basic example of privacy expectations for a person. I like to think of the context where you're sitting in a bar having a drink after work with a coworker, and you're talking about your boss, right? And you're saying some things to your coworker. Mm-hmm. You might not say to your coworker, hey, by the way, all of this information is private. Please don't share it with the boss. But you have that expectation nonetheless. You have an expectation about how that information is going to be used, and you have an expectation that the information that you're sharing with your coworker isn't going to go back to your boss. That it's not going to be used in a way that might harm your future employment prospects, even though, you know, if your boss knew the things that you were saying, they might. That's mm-hmm. kind of what we expect in an analog context. And what we don't expect is for someone that we're sharing information with, we have these norms and expectations, to just turn around and share that information with anyone else. Or to keep it forever, to hang on to it for 10 years, say, and then share it with someone down the line. When someone gives them money for it, and then it be used to turn around and harm you. So if you take that into the digital context, now I think that we do want information about ourselves not to be shared with third parties and used in ways that might harm us. But companies are kind of sucking up this information, and they might not necessarily be as sensitive to our expectations about how that information is going to be used as your coworker might in a bar. And it's basically impossible for us as users, for people who are going online and just kind of not really sharing information necessarily, but shedding information in a way about what we're doing online. It's really difficult for us to know what's going to happen with that and to have any sense that our expectations of the information will actually be respected by companies. So that's kind of like from the user's perspective. Sorry, go ahead.
Yeah. Well, no, I was going to say, and it feels like from the user perspective, we're playing catch up in a couple of different ways. One is we're just now starting to realize what you're saying, which is that the information is going a lot more places than we even initially thought, right? That we may have had an expectation that we got a free service in exchange for some advertising, but we didn't know how many other services might have our information. And now there's sort of like this new conversation about a pivot to privacy and encryption. Maybe while users are still figuring out the first part of the equation?
Yeah, I think that's right. And I think, and then just to complicate things even more, you throw into the mix the things that people are seeing as major digital concerns right now, like, there have been some research that's come out recently showing that advertisements that are distributed online for jobs are sometimes distributed in a way that's totally discriminatory, right? There was a study that came out just a couple months ago from researchers at Northeastern and an organization called Upturn that showed that these researchers just put some employment ads out on a major social media platform and found that some of those ads were being seen by audiences that were 65% white, or I'm sorry, 85% white, I think, 65% black, or 85% women, right? Ads that were going out there for jobs were being distributed in a way that was totally discriminatory. That kind of concern, I think people are really aware that there's now all this viral disinformation out on the internet and on some of these platforms in particular, and viral hate speech. These things are all things that we're seeing as major digital concerns. And when you take that, when you add that into the mix and think about the fact that all of those things are driven by algorithms that are trained and designed using information that, again, is collected from users about what they're doing online and what they're interested in, then that starts to look like another privacy violation, or maybe the harms of privacy violations that just kind of underscore the need to do something about this.
Yeah, let's dive in. You just said a really interesting thing, which is sort of sharing information versus shedding information. Mm-hmm. And let's dig into that a little bit, because that feels like an important distinction that gets to kind of this idea of whether we, the consumer, have any control about that, over this, whether we are intentional at all.
Right. Yeah. I mean, I think that sometimes you're online and you are making an affirmative choice to share information. You're actually typing in information into a field of a form, and that form is going to be sent to someone, or you're sending an email, or you're making a purchase online. But there's lots of other things that we do online that we don't necessarily think of as information sharing, but that nevertheless are shedding information about ourselves that can be sucked up by those who are in a position to view it. And that, that might be things like scrolling through an article or a website and pausing to look at things that are interesting on the page. Those pauses might indicate that you're interested in something, and that's actually generating information. The fact that you've paused there is generating information that can be sucked up and used to make inferences about what you're interested in. And you might not realize that you're sharing that information, but you are, just by pausing on the page and looking at something.
Is it the kind of thing where if we found out all of that, if you gave me a list of a thousand examples of a thing that I do every day that sheds information that companies rely on in order to create an advertising-based business model. Like, do you think that I would just reject the whole thing wholesale, or is it just that we just don't know, and everything that we find out feels like the last straw?
I don't know. I would. So, you know, I'm obviously a privacy person, and I do a lot of research and advocacy around privacy. I teach students at the law school about privacy, but I find it extremely difficult, impossible, in fact, to avoid sharing information with myself, including information that I don't want to share about myself. And mm-hmm. if I find it difficult, you know, I mean, not that I am the most savvy person out there, but if sophisticated folks consistently are saying it's really difficult or impossible to avoid sharing information with ourselves online, what hope is there for the average user who even if we were to give them all of as much information as we can about how they're shedding data about themselves and what uses might be made of that, they're going to find it really difficult. In fact, there's a bunch of research out there that shows that, there's a body of research out there into privacy policies, where researchers looked at how many privacy policies there are for sites and services that we encounter throughout the course of a day or a year, and how long they are, and calculated how much time it would take us to read those privacy policies and think about them and, you know, process them before making decisions about these sites and services. And they've demonstrated that, as a practical matter, it is truly impossible. There simply are not enough hours in the day for a person to read and digest privacy policies of all of the sites and services that they use. So if we can't mm-hmm. even hope to read and process privacy policies, and we can't really avoid going online, what can we do about it? You know what I mean? So I'd like to say yes, we'll all be more observant of privacy, but I think, as a practical matter, in the absence of regulation, most users of online services have just kind of thrown up their hands and are resigned to the fact that they're going to have to share information about themselves to use services that we're all dependent on these days.
Right. Well, let's see if we can get on the same, if we can at least try to get on the same page definition-wise. Maybe right. That will help people as they craft regulation. What sure. Okay, so now you have these companies. You have Apple and you have Facebook on some level, Google a little bit, sort of starting to talk about privacy. What mm-hmm. do they mean when they say privacy? Then we'll That's talk about great... what consumers mean, but let's start with these companies.
So I think I hate to give the lawyerly answer, which is always it depends, but I think it depends, right? And okay. and it depends in part on what the revenue model of the company is. So, you know, what's driving a company? So if you look at a company right. that's a
let's say
hardware
Facebook.
Company. Yeah, right. So Facebook, I mean, for Facebook, Facebook makes its money from advertising. And so if you center that in your thinking about Facebook and what privacy means to a company like Facebook, you have to understand that their entire existence relies on the ability to take information about users and what they're interested in and efficiently deliver them ads and information about things that they're interested in to show them content that's going to keep them on the platform for longer periods of time and ads that align with their interests that they'll click on those ads and hopefully buy things. And so, you know, so privacy to a company like Facebook is, you know, and I do think, you know, I mean, Facebook has been hiring and trying to do some things on privacy, but privacy to a company like Facebook is always going to mean, I think, maybe trying to make sure that users know how their information is being used, maybe trying to make sure that a situation like Cambridge Analytica doesn't happen again, where some, you know, third party sets up an application on Facebook and sucks up all this user data without users really being aware of where it's going. But it's probably not going to mean what I mean by privacy, it's probably not going to mean that users on the platform are able to prevent information about themselves from being used to make decisions about how content and ads are distributed that ultimately are harmful and maybe discriminatory. I just think it's mm-hmm. really going to be very difficult for a platform like that that's driven by advertising to observe privacy in a truly beneficial way.
And then let's say you started to talk about a hardware company. Let's say you're Apple, but you still run a bunch of apps and you still have a bunch of services and you run on top of a cell network that's gathering my location information all the time. Can Apple even realistically make an expectation of privacy or a promise of privacy that matches up with what we consumers think that means?
I think that when you're looking at a hardware company that makes its money primarily from selling hardware, it's easier for a company like that to deliver privacy in a way that is consistent with what people want without harming its bottom line, right? So, I mean, I do think that Apple has done a pretty good job on privacy. It's not always perfect, but it's been pretty good on privacy. And a large part of that just comes from the fact that it can make promises on privacy and keep them without being concerned that it's not going to be able to carry on its primary business. And with Apple also it's not really an advertising platform, it doesn't need consumer data about consumer level interest data in the same way that a company like Facebook does.
Okay, then, weirdly, Google gets left out of these conversations a lot lately. Where's Google in all this? I mean, it is also a big advertising-supported platform with arguably even more connections into our personal information. What do they mean if and when they say privacy?
Yeah, I mean, and Google also has access to a ton of information about users through mobile devices. You know, you mentioned a minute ago Apple being connected to cellular networks that can access consumer data. I mean, Google has its platform running on people's cell phones, and through that can suck up all kinds of information about behavior and location just based on the movements of phones and what people are doing using their phones. So I think to a company like Google, again, privacy is going to mean something more like what Facebook means, which is let's be a little more transparent about how we're using information so that we avoid the most disastrous situations of consumers finding out after the fact that their information's been used or shared in some way that they find truly objectionable. But it's probably not going to mean don't collect information about consumers and use it to make decisions about how they receive content and ads, because that's what the entire business is based on.
So short of banning targeted advertising, which comes up occasionally, what do you think can be done? Like, if you were going to try to craft a regulation, is there a way to get consumers and companies on the same page, or at least closer to the same page?
Yeah, so it's very hard. It's very hard, and there are a lot of really smart, dedicated people who are working on this in Congress right now and having a very difficult time. And I think a lot of it, a lot of the difficulty comes from the fact that, as I said before, for real privacy now, the ability to prevent information about ourselves from being used in ways that are harmful, not just to ourselves, but to society, through these things like discriminatory advertising and amplification of hate speech and political disinformation that then leads to political polarization, it's probably not going to be enough for us to come out with a regulation that just forces greater transparency to consumers about how their information is being used and then requires companies to get permission. It's referred to as the notice and consent model. I don't think that's going to be enough to prevent the privacy harms that we're seeing today. and get at the things that people are really worried about. So what should regulation do? I think that it really should target these harmful uses of information. We need privacy regulation that doesn't just require notice and consent, but that actually prohibits information about consumers from being used to deliver ads, especially ads about things like housing and employment and credit, in ways that are discriminatory. Or, you know, we maybe need companies to be required to conduct assessments of how consumer information is going to be used, and to think in advance of whether there's a likelihood that that some use of consumer data is going to lead to discrimination, or again, some of these other things is likely to exacerbate political disinformation or hate speech, because you know that those are the real harms that we're really worried about. And so, if companies are going to be using user data that they're sucking up to make decisions about all of these other things, then they have a responsibility, or, you know, I would argue that they have a responsibility. I'd like them to have a legal responsibility, too. They have a responsibility to make sure that that's done in a way that is actually responsible and isn't discriminatory and ultimately really harmful to society.
And then how much more urgent does this start to get as we look down the road at these next generation technologies, artificial intelligence, which relies on a ton of data for learning, for machine learning, and biometrics, which is gathering information that we cannot change, like our retina scans or our fingerprints? Do we need to get this sorted out real soon here?
Yeah, I mean, I think that we've needed to get it sorted out real soon for a long time, and it's continuing to be really urgent because it used to be the case that it was expensive to collect information about people and then store it indefinitely, that storage space was finite. And so companies eventually had to get rid of information about consumers. That's no longer the case, right? We're basically past the days of finite storage, and we're in a time period where information that companies collect potentially could last forever. They could keep that information forever. And as you say, some of that information will never change, right? So if information about you is collected and it includes biometric information, That information is never going away. You're not going to be able to change your face in 10 years in such a way that that information associated with your face will no longer be associated with you. So it's been urgent. But you also asked a question in there about machine learning, and I do think that in some ways the rise of machine learning makes it more urgent for us to figure some of these things out. If only because there are inferences that can be drawn about our private lives from our information that are becoming possible because of new data processing techniques that weren't available a few years ago. So, we've always known that information about your private life, about your romantic and sexual preferences, about your political preferences and your religious viewpoints, your ethnic and social identity, that these things can be inferred from other things. You know, that we can learn what your political preferences are, for example, from websites that you're visiting, or romantic and sexual preferences from movies that you're watching. We can learn about your ethnic and social identity from products that you're purchasing online. Those inferences are the ability to make inferences from information that we don't necessarily think of as revealing those things are become that ability is becoming stronger. The inferences are becoming more powerful. And that trend is only going to continue as machine learning techniques evolve and we develop new data processing techniques.
So shadow profiles are real, is what you're saying.
I mean, I'm concerned.
Laura Moy is an associate professor of law and the director of the Communications and Technology Law Clinic at Georgetown. Laura, thanks so much for the time.
Great. Thank you.
All right, everybody, what do you think? I hope that we have not freaked you out, that we have only helped to clarify this conversation so that you know what to ask for. Send us a voice memo with your thoughts at makemesmart@marketplace.org. We're going to take a quick break, and then we'll be right back. All right, so just some real quick thoughts, like a mini news fix, if you will, since Kai is not here to engage. And since he's not here, I didn't put a link in the document, as you might imagine. But really, I think that a lot of us, we talk a lot on this show about whether people actually care about their privacy. And that is the eternal question. What are people's expectations? But I continue to believe that those expectations are starting to change. And part of it is because it does feel so overwhelming. And I have watched, you know, people I know make this journey from, I don't care, I can't control it, I don't have anything to hide, I let this thing do whatever I want. And then they start to encounter the consequences in the real world, whether that's that mysterious thing where you're pretty sure you said something that you've never typed into a search engine, but it showed up in your Instagram feed as an ad, or you start to feel the effect of your filter bubble when you realize that you haven't seen information that doesn't reinforce something that you believe, or you just start to realize how much radicalization or misinformation is starting to spread around the world as a result of this really targeted advertising and information and the ability to reach people based on their personal data. I think we are getting to a tipping point, and and then people's frustration is exacerbated, like mine is, by the fact that there's really only so much you can do. Like, sure, I use DuckDuckGo. I try to keep my searches private. I've started using Apple Maps instead of Google. But as we just heard from Laura, that doesn't mean I'm not on the web. That doesn't mean I'm not pausing on a website or, heaven help me, occasionally clicking on an ad. And I think that points to the frustration that we all feel, which is that there's only so much we can do and that we need a better understanding of what's a bad thing to do online and what's not, so that we can adjust our behaviors accordingly. Anyway, it is a tiring experiment, but I guess the short version of what I'm trying to say is care about your privacy just a little. All right. It is time for the Make Me Smart answer, which actually is about digital media and digital information and the value of it. The question, of course, is what is something you thought you knew that you later found out you were wrong about? Our senior producer, Eve Tro, recently went to VidCon, the online video conference held in Anaheim for influencers and YouTube stars and their fans. I blame myself for this, for sending her, but now she's been 2 years in a row, so I think she kind of loves it. Eve caught up with Savannah Sellers. She hosts NBC's Stay Tuned, which is a Gen Z news show that airs on Snapchat and other platforms. And here's what she said in answer to that question.
I did not think that news was going to work on Snapchat. And it turns out I was wrong. Making young people decide that they want to engage with the world around them, it never gets old. Especially in digital media, and unfortunately, especially via social media platforms, we are dealing with this crisis of fake news, and it's damaging, it's incorrect, it hurts our democracy, it's hurtful to other people, it spreads hate. And so I think for young people who grow up totally invested in these platforms and spending a majority of their time, honestly, engaging with these platforms on their phones, on their tablets, on their computer screens, it feels like we're helping them understand the difference between fact and fiction.
More, we will have a link to more information on Stay Tuned here, but honestly, anything that is helping anybody understand the difference between fact and fiction is great in life right now. Now, before we left Savannah, she gave us another answer, a quick triple threat answer to the Make Me Smart question.
Something that I thought was true that is wrong is I thought we'd seen the last of the Jonas Brothers, and they're back in full force. I'm a sucker for you. Say the word and I'll go anywhere
blindly. I'm a sucker for you. Yeah. You can't see me. Maybe you can if you're watching our video on YouTube, but I'm dancing and singing along. Heaven help me. You can tell that Savannah must be Gen Z because otherwise she would know that your favorite bands from high school never go away. There will never be a time in my life, apparently, when the Red Hot Chili Peppers are not touring. The Jonas Brothers just started their tour, in fact. What is your answer to the Make Me Smart question? Let us know. That question, again, is what is something you thought you knew and you later found out you were wrong about? MakeMeSmart@marketplace.org is our email address. And don't forget to subscribe to the Make Me Smart newsletter. You can sign up at marketplace.org/newsletters. Make Me Smart is produced by Shara Morris. Our senior producer is Eve Tro. Tony Wagner is our digital producer. Thank you to our video producers, Ben Hethcote and Summer Dunsmore. This week's program was engineered by Drew Jostad. Thanks also to Christian Buckler in D.C. Our theme music was composed by Ben Tolliday and Daniel Ramirez. The executive director of On Demand is Satara Nieves. And the senior vice president and general manager is Deborah Clark. We miss you, Kai. Come back soon. It's not the same without you. We're suckers for you? Nah, that's too far. That's just weird. I just made it weird. I'm a sucker for you. I'm not proud, you guys, but that song is so catchy.